The following is a free-for-download audiobook available on Google Drive. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 66, Pondraka, the False Vasudeva. This chapter relates how Lord Krishna went to Kashi, present-day Benares, and killed Pondraka and Kashi Raj, and how the Lord Sudarshan Disc defeated a demon, incinerated the city of Kashi, and killed Sudakshin. While Lord Baladev was visiting Vraja, King Pondraka of Kurusha, encouraged by fools, announced that he was the real Vasudeva. Thus he challenged Lord Krishna with the following message, quote, "Since I alone am the true personality of Godhead, you should give up your false claim to this position, as well as my divine symbols, and take shelter of me. If you do not, then prepare for battle." End quote. When Ugrasima and the members of his royal assembly heard Pondraka's foolish boast, they all laughed heartily. Sri Krishna then told Pondraka's messenger to convey a message to his master, quote, "O fool, I will force you to give up the so-called Sudarshan disc and the other divine symbols of mine you have dared to assume, and when you lie down on the battlefield, you will become the shelter of dogs," end quote. Lord Krishna then went to Kashi. Pondraka, seeing the Lord preparing for battle, quickly came out of the city to confront him with his army. His friend Kashiraj followed him, leading the rear guard. Just as the fire of universal devastation destroys every living being in all directions, so Lord Krishna annihilated the armies of Pondraka and Kashiraj. Then, after chastising Pondraka, the Lord beheaded both him and Kashiraj with his Sudarshan disc. Thereafter, he returned to Dwarka. Because Pondraka had constantly meditated on the Supreme Lord, even dressing like him, he gained liberation. When Krishna beheaded Kashiraj, the king's head flew into his city, and when his queens, sons, and other relatives saw it, they all began to lament. At that time, a son of Kashiraj's named Sudakshin, wanting to avenge his father's death, began worshipping Lord Shiva with the intention of destroying his father's killer. Gratified by Sudakshin's worship, Lord Shiva offered him a choice of benedictions, and Sudakshin asked for a means to kill the one who had slain his father. Lord Shiva advised him to worship the Dakshinagni fire with black art rituals. This Sudakshin did, with the result that a fearsome demon with a body of flames appeared from the pit of the sacrificial fire. The demon rose up carrying a fiery trident and at once set out for Dwarka. The residents of Lord Krishna's capital became terrified as the demon approached the city, but Lord Krishna assured them of protection and dispatched his Sudarshan Chakra to oppose the magic creation of Lord Shiva. The Sudarshan overpowered the demon and then returned to Varanasi and burned Sudakshin to ashes together with his priests. The Sudarshan disc, following the demon, entered Varanasi and burned the entire city to the ground. Then the Lord's disc returned to his side in Dwarka. Text 1. Shukadeva Goswami said, "O King, when Lord Balaram was away visiting Nanda's village of Vraja, the ruler of Kurusha, foolishly thinking, quote, 'I am the Supreme Lord, Vasudeva,' end quote, sent a messenger to Lord Krishna." Purport. Since Lord Ram had gone to Nandavraja, Pondraka foolishly thought that Lord Krishna would be alone and therefore easy to challenge. Thus, he dared to send his crazy message to the Lord. Text 2. Pondraka was emboldened by the flattery of childish men who told him, quote, "You are Vasudeva, the Supreme Lord and Master of the Universe, who have now descended to the earth," end quote. Thus, he imagined himself to be the infallible personality of Godhead. Purport. Pondraka foolishly accepted the flattery of ignorant persons. Text 3. Thus, slow-witted King Pondraka sent a messenger to the inscrutable Lord Krishna at Dwarka. Pondraka was acting like an unintelligent child whom the other children are pretending is a king. Purport. According to Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur, the reason Shukadev Goswami here mentions for the second time that Pondraka sent a message to Lord Krishna is that the great stage is astonished at Pondraka's extreme foolishness. Text 4. Arriving in Dwarka, the messenger found lotus-eyed Krishna in his royal assembly and relayed the king's message to that almighty lord. Text 5. On Pandraka's behalf, the messenger said, "I am the one and only Lord Vasudev, and there is no other. It is I who have descended to this world to show mercy to the living beings. Therefore, give up your false name." Purport. Inspired by Goddess Saraswati, Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti gives the real import of these two verses. Quote, "I am not Vasudev incarnate, but rather you alone and no one else are Vasudev. You have descended to show mercy to the living beings, so please make me give up my false designation, which is like that of an oyster claiming to be silver." End quote. The Supreme Lord will certainly comply with this request. Text 6. O Satvata, give up my personal symbols, which out of foolishness you now carry, and come to me for shelter. If you do not, then you must give me battle. Purport. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti again interprets Pandraka's words according to the inspiration of Saraswati, the goddess of learning. Thus they may be understood to mean, quote, "Out of foolishness, I have assumed an imitation conch shell disc, lotus, and club, and you are maintaining these by allowing me to use them. You have not yet subdued me and gotten rid of these imitation symbols. Therefore, please mercifully come and liberate me by forcing me to give them up. Give me battle and grant me liberation by killing me." End quote. Text 7. Shukadev Goswami said, "King Ugrasena and the other members of the assembly laughed loudly when they heard this vain boasting of unintelligent Pondraka." Text 8. The personality of Godhead, after enjoying the jokes of the assembly, told the messenger to relay to his master, quote, "You fool, I will indeed let loose the weapons you boast of in this way." Purport. The Sanskrit word utshrakshye means, quote, "I will hurl, throw, let loose, abandon, etc." End quote. Foolish Pondraka demanded that Lord Krishna give up his powerful weapons, such as the disc and the club, and here the Lord replies, "Utshrakshye mudha chinani," quote, "Yes, fool, I will indeed let loose these weapons when we meet on the battlefield," end quote. In Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Srila Prabhupada nicely describes this scene as follows, quote, "When all the members of the royal assembly, including King Ugrasena, heard this message sent by Pondraka, they laughed very loudly for a considerable time. After enjoying the loud laughter of all the members of the assembly, Krishna replied to the messenger as follows, quote, "O messenger of Pondraka, you may carry my message to your master. He is a foolish rascal. I directly call him a rascal, and I refuse to follow his instructions. I shall never give up the symbols of Vasudev, especially my disc. I shall use this disc to kill not only King Pondraka, but all his followers also. I shall destroy this Pondraka and his foolish associates, who merely constitute a society of cheaters and the cheated." End quote. Text 9. "When you lie dead, O fool, your face covered by vultures, herons, and vata birds, you will become the shelter of dogs," end quote. Purport. Pondraka foolishly told the Supreme Lord to come to him for shelter, but here Lord Krishna tells him, quote, "You are not my shelter, but rather you shall become the shelter of dogs when they happily feast on your dead body," end quote. Srila Prabhupada vividly describes this scene as follows, quote, Lord Krishna told Pondraka, "When I shall destroy you, O foolish king, then you will have to conceal your face in disgrace. When your head is severed from your body by my disc, it will be surrounded by meat-eating birds like vultures, hawks, and eagles. At that time, instead of becoming my shelter, as you have demanded, you will be subject to the mercy of these low-born birds. At that time, your body will be thrown to the dogs, who will eat it with great pleasure. End quote. Text 10. When the Supreme Lord had thus spoken, the messenger conveyed his insulting reply to his master in its entirety. Lord Krishna then mounted his chariot and then went to the vicinity of Kashi. Purport. In Krishna, Srila Prabhupada describes this incident as follows, quote, the messenger carried the words of Lord Krishna to his master Pondraka, who patiently heard all these insults. Without waiting any longer, Lord Sri Krishna immediately started out on his chariot to punish the rascal Pondraka, the king of Karusha, because at that time he was living with his friend, the king of Kashi. Krishna surrounded the whole city of Kashi. Text 11. Upon observing Lord Krishna's preparations for battle, the mighty warrior Pondraka quickly went out of the city with two full military divisions. Text 12 through 14. Pondraka's friend, the king of Kashi, followed behind, O king, leading the rear guard with three Akshahini divisions. Lord Krishna saw that Pondraka was carrying the Lord's own insignia, such as the conch shell, disc, sword, and club, and also an imitation Saringa bow and Shivatsa mark. He wore a mock Kushtuba gem, which is decorated with a garland of forest flowers, and was dressed in upper and lower garments of fine yellow silk. His banner bore the image of Garuda, and he wore a valuable crown and gleaming sharp-shaped earrings. Purport. Srila Prabhupada comments in Krishna, quote, when the two kings came before Lord Krishna to oppose him, Krishna saw Pondraka face to face for the first time. End quote. Text 15. Lord Hari laughed heartily when he saw how the king had dressed up an exact imitation of his own appearance, just like an actor on stage. Purport. Srila Prabhupada describes this scene as follows, quote, on the whole, however, Pondraka's dress and makeup were clearly imitation. Anyone could understand that he was just like someone on stage playing the part of Vasudeva in a false dress. When Lord Sri Krishna saw Pondraka imitating his posture and dress, he could not check his laughter, and thus he laughed with great satisfaction. End quote. Srila Jiva Goswami points out that it was a benediction from Lord Shiva that enabled Pondraka to imitate the Lord's dress and appearance exactly, a fact gleaned from the Uttarakhanda of Sri Padma Purana. Text 16. The enemies of Lord Hari attacked him with tridents, clubs, bludgeons, pikes, rishtis, barbed darts, lances, swords, axes, and arrows. Text 17. But Lord Krishna fiercely struck back at the army of Pondraka and Kashiraj, which consisted of elephants, chariots, cavalry, and infantry. The Lord tormented his enemies with his club, sword, Sudarshan disc, and arrows, just as the fire of annihilation torments the various kinds of creatures at the end of a cosmic age. Purport. Srila Prabhupada comments as follows in Krishna, quote, the soldiers on the side of King Pondraka began to shower their weapons upon Krishna. The weapons, including various kinds of tridents, clubs, poles, lances, swords, daggers, and arrows, came flying in waves, and Krishna counteracted them. He smashed not only the weapons, but also the soldiers and assistants of Pondraka, just as during the dissolution of this universe, the fire of devastation burns everything to ashes. The elephants, chariots, horses, and infantry belonging to the opposite party were scattered by the weapons of Lord Krishna. End quote. Text 18. The battlefield strewn with the dismembered chariots, horses, elephants, humans, mules, and camels that had been cut to pieces by the Lord's disc weapon shone like the gruesome playground of Lord Bhutapati, giving pleasure to the wise. Purport. Srila Prabhupada describes this scene as follows, quote, although the devastated battlefield appeared like the dancing place of Lord Shiva at the time of the dissolution of the world, the warriors who were on the side of Krishna were very much encouraged by seeing this, and they fought with greater strength. End quote. Text 19. Lord Krishna then addressed Pondraka. My dear Pondraka, the very weapons you spoke of through your messenger, I now release unto you. Purport. Srila Prabhupada writes as follows in Krishna, quote, at this time, Lord Krishna told Pondraka, quote, Pondraka, you requested me to give up the symbols of Lord Vishnu, specifically my disc. Now I will give it up to you. Be careful. You falsely declare yourself to be Vasudev, imitating me. Therefore, no one is a greater fool than you. End quote. From this statement of Krishna's, it is clear that any rascal who advertises himself as God is the greatest fool in human society. End quote. Text 20. O fool, I now shall make you renounce my name, which you have falsely assumed, and I will certainly take shelter of you if I do not wish to fight you. Purport. Srila Prabhupada writes as follows, quote, now, Pondraka, I shall force you to give up this false representation. You wanted me to surrender unto you. Now, this is your opportunity. We shall fight, and if I am defeated and you become victorious, I shall certainly surrender unto you. End quote. Text 21. Thus, having derided Pondraka, Lord Krishna destroyed his chariot with his sharp arrows. The Lord then cut off his head with the Sudarshan disc, just as Lord Indra lops off a mountain peak with his thunderbolt weapon. Text 22. With his arrows, Lord Krishna similarly severed Kashiraj's head from his body, sending it flying into Kashi's city like a lotus flower thrown by the wind. Purport. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti explains why Krishna threw Kashiraj's head into the city. Quote, as he went off to battle, the king of Kashi had promised the citizens, quote, my dear residents of Kashi, today I will bring the enemy's head into the midst of the city. Have no doubt of this. End quote. The king's sinful queens had also boasted of their maids-in-waiting, to their maids-in-waiting, quote, today our master will certainly bring the head of the Lord of Dwarka. End quote. Therefore, the Supreme Lord threw the king's head into the city to astonish the inhabitants. End quote. Text 23. Having thus killed envious Pondraka and his ally, Lord Krishna returned to Dwarka. As he entered the city, the cities of heaven chanted his immortal nectarian glories. Text 24. By constantly meditating on the Supreme Lord, Pondraka shattered all his material bonds. Indeed, by imitating Lord Krishna's appearance, O King, he ultimately became Krishna conscious. Purport. Srila Prabhupada writes as follows in Krishna, quote, as far as Pondraka was concerned, somehow or other he always thought of Vasudev by falsely dressing himself in imitation of the Lord. Therefore, Pondraka achieved Sarupya, one of the five kinds of liberation, and was thus promoted to the Vaikuntha planets, where devotees have the same bodily features as Vishnu, with four hands holding the four symbols. Factually, his meditation was concentrated on the Vishnu form, but because he thought himself Lord Vishnu, he was offensive. After being killed by Krishna, however, that offense was also mitigated. Thus, he was given Sarupya liberation, and he attained the same form as the Lord. End quote. Text 25. Seeing a head decorated with earrings lying at the gate of the royal palace, the people present were puzzled. Some of them asked, quote, what is this? End quote. And others asked, it is a head, but whose is it? End quote. Purport. Srila Prabhupada writes as follows, quote, when the head of the king of Kashi was thrown into the city through the city gate, people gathered and were astonished to see that wonderful thing. When they found out that there were earrings on it, they could understand that it was somebody's head. They conjectured as to whose head it might be. Some thought it was Krishna's head because Krishna was the enemy of Kashiraj, and they calculated that the king of Kashi might have thrown Krishna's head into the city so that people might take pleasure in the enemies having been killed. But it was finally detected that the head was not Krishna's, but that of Kashiraj himself. End quote. Text 26. My dear king, when they recognized it as the head of their king, the Lord of Kashi, his queens, sons, and other relatives, along with all the citizens of the city, began to cry pitifully, quote, "Alas, we are killed! O my lord, my lord!" End quote. Text 27 and 28. After the king's son Shudakshin had performed the obligatory funeral rites for his father, he resolved within his mind, quote, "Only by killing my father's murderer can I avenge his death," end quote. Thus, the charitable Shudakshin, together with his priests, began worshiping Lord Maheshwar with great attention. Purport. Srila Prabhupada writes, "The Lord of the Kingdom of Kashi was Vishwanath, Lord Shiva. The temple of Lord Vishwanath is still existing in Varanasi, and many thousands of pilgrims still gather daily in that temple." End quote. Text 29. Satisfied by the worship, the powerful Lord Shiva appeared in the sacred precinct of Abhimukta and offered Shudakshin his choice of benedictions. The prince chose as his benediction a means to slay his father's killer. Text 30 and 31. Lord Shiva told him, quote, "Accompanied by brahmanas, serve the Dakshinagni fire, the original priest, following the injunctions of the Abhichara ritual. Then the Dakshinagni fire, along, together with many pramathas, will fulfill your desire if you direct it against someone inimical to the brahmanas," end quote. So instructed, Shudakshin strictly observed the ritual vows and invoked the Abhichara against Lord Krishna. Purport. It is clearly stated here that the powerful Dakshinagni fire could be directed only against someone unfavorable to Brahminical culture. Lord Krishna, however, is most favorable to the Brahmanas and in fact maintains the Brahminical culture. Lord Shiva thus knew that if Shudakshin attempted to direct the power of this ritual against Lord Krishna, Shudakshin himself would perish. Text 32 and 33. Thereupon, the fire rose up out of the altar pit, assuming the form of an extremely fearsome, naked person. The fiery creature's beard and tuft of hair were like molten copper, and his eyes emitted blazing hot cinders. His face looked most frightful with its fangs and terrible arched and furrowed brows. As he licked the corners of his mouth with his tongue, the demon shook his flaming trident. Purport, or text 34. As on legs as tall as palm trees, the monster raced toward Dwarka in the company of ghostly spirits, shaking the ground and burning the world in all directions. Text 35. Seeing the approach of the fiery demon created by the Abhichara ritual, the residents of Dwarka were all struck with fear, like animals terrified by a forest fire. Text 36. Distraught with fear, the people cried out to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who was then playing at dice in the royal court. Quote, save us, O Lord of the three worlds, from this fire burning up the city, end quote. Text 37. When Lord Krishna heard the people's agitation and saw that even his own men were disturbed, that most worthy giver of shelter simply laughed and told them, quote, do not fear, I shall protect you, end quote. Text 38. The Almighty Lord, with the internal and external witness of all, understood that the monster had been produced by Lord Shiva from the sacrificial fire. To defeat the demon, Krishna dispatched his distwa weapon, who was waiting at his side. Purport. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti comments that Lord Krishna, playing the part of a king, was absorbed in a gambling match and did not want to be disturbed by such an insignificant matter as the attack of a fiery demon. So he simply dispatched his chakra weapon and ordered him to take the necessary steps. Text 39. That Shudarshan, the disc weapon of Lord Mukunda, blazed forth like millions of suns. His effulgence blazed like the fire of universal annihilation, and with his heat, he pained the sky, all the directions, heaven and earth, and also the fiery demon. Text 40. Frustrated by the power of Lord Krishna's weapon, O king, the fiery creature produced by black magic, turned his face away and retreated. Created for violence, the demon then returned to Varanasi, where he surrounded the city and then burned Shudakshin and his priests to death, even though Shudakshin was his creator. Srila Prabhupada comments as follows. Having failed to set fire to Dwarka, the fiery demon went back to Varanasi, the kingdom of Kashiraj. As a result of his return, all the priests who had helped instruct the black art of mantras, along with their employer, Shudakshin, were burned to ashes by the glaring effulgence of the fiery demon. According to the methods of black art mantras instructed in the Tantra, if the mantra fails to kill the enemy, then, because it must kill someone, it kills the original creator. Shudakshin was the originator, and the priests assisted him. Therefore, all of them were burned to ashes. This is the way of the demons. The demons creates something to kill God, but by the same weapon, the demons themselves are killed. End quote. Text 41. Lord Vishnu's disc also entered Varanasi in pursuit of the fiery demon and proceeded to burn the city to the ground, including all its assembly halls and residential palaces with raised porches, its numerous marketplaces, gateways, watchtowers, warehouses, and treasuries, and all the buildings housing elephants, horses, chariots, and grains. Text 42. After burning down the entire city of Varanasi, Lord Vishnu Sudarshan Chakra returned to the side of Lord Krishna, whose actions are effortless. Text 43. Any mortal who he recounts this heroic pastime of Lord Uttama Shloka's, or who simply hears it attentively, will become freed from all sins. Purport. Thus end the purports of the humble servants of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, to the 10th canto, 66th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled Pondraka, the False Vasudeva.